Well, thank you, Ambassador. The question that you have given us is a difficult question to answer. I say difficult because the word ever seems to suggest that you are required to make a prediction for all times to come. And I wouldn't venture to do that. But I can say that for the foreseeable future, we are not likely to have a good neighborly relationship with Pakistan. For various reasons which were mentioned earlier, but essentially to do with the internal dynamics of Pakistan. It's a dysfunctional state, the stranglehold of the army. I don't believe the army has changed its worldview. It may take quite some time for it to do that, if it ever happens. The fact that they haven't given up the instrumentality of terror, and that those terrorists continue to destabilize not only Pakistan, but threaten the stability of the entire region. There are silver linings, which we should not lose sight of, and I'll come to that a little later. But they don't add up for the moment to a stage where you could say that we will have a good neighborly relationship sometime in the near future, or foreseeable future. So instead of spending too much of time on whether we will have a good neighborly relationship or not, I would much rather focus on how do we manage this relationship. And there I believe this attractive sounding, it's very appealing, but to my mind a little simplistic approach of terror and dialogue cannot go together. It seems to suggest that we'll engage with Pakistan only when Pakistan becomes a normal state. When it gives up the instrumentality of terror, almost a state of our dreams. Now that, for the reasons that I mentioned very briefly, is not going to happen anytime soon. And as I say, often we have to deal with Pakistan as it is and not as we want it to be. The second, I think our national debate has focused far too much on this false binary of dialogue versus no dialogue. I believe this binary does not address the complexity of the situation facing us, nor does it serve our interest. And let me explain why. Pakistan, although I have said that, you know, the army is stranglehold and so on, but Pakistan is not a monolith. Its army, their terror proxies, the politicians hanging on to their coattails and so on, they have one view about India. They spike every peace move. But you also have a large constituency within Pakistan which believes in the need for their own interest, a stable relationship with India. Amongst them, I count today the leaders of the major political parties which are capable of winning power through electoral politics. So therefore, they regard a stable relationship with India as a way of undercutting the salience of the army within the Pakistani polity. You then have the large, a substantial segment of the industry and business in Pakistan, which is looking for lucrative opportunities. And as my colleague said here, even the army sometimes, you know, they have been exporting cement, the Fauji Foundation, to India. So that's another constituency that is looking for a stable relationship. When it comes to the people of Pakistan, my belief is that if you were to take an active opinion poll, they would voice their national positions. But it's not as if they get up hating India, they live the day hating India, and they go to sleep hating India. In fact, India, I think someone said here that, you know, they have become part of our electoral politics, and India has been a part of Pakistan's electoral politics. But India was not an issue in Pakistan's election, an issue of consequence. Both in 2008 and 2013, I was there, I saw. There's no, very little mention of India. Nawaz Sharif saying we'll build better relationship and so on. So that's another thing we have to take into account. It's only during period of tension, such as this one, that opinion consolidates in favor of the army in Pakistan, which is seen as the savior. Next, we come to dialogue, and I believe we get frustrated with dialogue because we regard it as a concession to Pakistan, in return for which Pakistan should become a normal state. I don't think that absence of dialogue gives us any leverage in changing the behavior of Pakistan. But a dialogue, according to me, serves some other purposes, lesser, nonetheless important goals. One of managing the relationship so that its violent swings do not take our attention away from larger issues, economic transformation of the country, China, and increasingly assertive China. Secondly, it helps us in keeping in touch with the constituencies in Pakistan which believe in the need for a stable relationship with India. Third, and I think in the past we know this, we have made incremental gains, albeit incremental, in areas such as trade and people-to-people contacts through dialogue. And those are the subjects which are anathema to Pakistan's security establishment. Now, taking all that into account, I think the way forward for us is to manage this relationship by combining dialogue with deterrence. And I believe the dialogue can be combined with deterrence, provided you exercise the deterrence with discretion, in a discreet manner, and not as an exercise in point scoring. I think that's important. The last point, or one or two points I would wish to make, is that we need to build a political consensus within India, which I believe is lacking in terms of our policy towards Pakistan. The manner in which Pakistan has become a subject of electoral politics in India over the last few years, it does not leave much space for rational foreign policy choices, frankly. So we need to build a foreign policy consensus within India. Lastly, you know, this issue of engaging with the real power center, the army. I believe this approach has serious limitations. The army may change one day, but according to me, their worldview hasn't changed so far. Their institutional interest is served by having an adversarial relationship with India, because of which we engage with them. We engage commanders, you know, manage the situation on the line of control, flag meetings, and so on. There are other contexts for managing the relationship. So I'm not saying that you should have no context. Those contexts should always be maintained to manage the relationship. But I don't think it is an approach which would give you satisfaction on the more substantive issues. The first thing that they are going to turn around and say is, why not demilitarize Siachen? Are we willing to do that? That's the question that I ask. Thank you.